Welcome, one and all, to another episode. In this episode, we are discussing the King James Version. We're discussing some arguments from Will Kinney, and we're thinking about an upcoming debate. So I guess I could have titled this some kind of preposode, since it should be a preparatory episode for my upcoming debate with Will Kinney. My debate proposal for my debate with Will Kinney, and it's going to probably be in more of a discussion format than a strict debate format, if I understand correctly. But I have proposed a number of issues, broadly two main categories, names and some issues in Revelation. In terms of names, I proposed talking about the name Peter, well, not the name Peter, but the name Simeon or Simon, which is, you know, Peter's birth name, and then the spelling Balak with a C or Balak with a K. We could do, with as far as Balak versus Balak, we could also have Rebecca versus Rebecca. We could have Joshua versus Jesus. There's lots of names like this where there's two different spellings in the King James. It doesn't have, there's not a lot of rhyme or reason to the choice to have different spellings of different names in the translation. Now, in terms of Timothy versus Timotheus, another interesting question, 19 times it's Timotheus, 9 times it's Timothy, but never Timotheos, which would be a more accurate transliteration from Greek, oddly enough. Next going to turn to unicorn. I mean, I don't know if this is the flow will actually take place during the debate or discussion. This is just my own outline. Then we turn to discussion of unicorns, which I've had a full debate on with Nick Sayers, and then also satyr, which should be wild goat. And I'll come back to that one because that's the main topic for today. Then the Passover, which again, I've debated with Nick, and then some differences between the majority text and the Textus Receptus in Revelation. Places where the TR agrees with the Nestle-Aland 28 against the majority, places where it disagrees with the Nestle-Aland 28 and the majority, and, you know, dig into that and try to understand what, if any, value the approach of holding up the King James as some kind of totally perfect standard that can't be improved, what good that is, if any. But my own suggestion for King James Version improvement today is going to focus on satyrs or satyrs. There's different pronunciations. It seems as though this is one of those terms that we kind of fly by if we're doing a read through the Bible in a year. You may fly through it while you're going through Isaiah. There's not a lot of time spent on it. The author of scripture, even whether or not this should be satyr or satyr or whatever it is, but whatever it is, it's not often mentioned as such in the King James. So the King James uses it in two places, in Isaiah 13, 21, and then again in Isaiah 34, 14. And the context in both cases is quite similar. We'll get to that a little bit later on. D.A. Waite Jr.'s 4,114 definitions from the Defined King James Bible provides a definition for satyr or satyr as, and I apologize for my pronunciation, it's all over the place. I'm not sure what's the official pronunciation of the word. I should probably have checked that before I get started. Huh? Let's see. Satyr apparently is the official satyr. So we'll go with satyr for now on. So D.A. Waite says, in mythology, a minor woodland deity, companion of Bacchus, depicted as having the pointed ears, legs, and short horns of a goat, the head and body of a man, and a fondness for unrestrained revelry and lechery. And indeed, if you look at any old paintings of satyrs, which I don't recommend doing, they do tend to have very graphic depictions. Kurt the Gamer says, I've always heard satyr. I've heard it both ways. And the most recent, the place I checked online just now said satyr. So I don't know. It could be satyr or satyr. But anyway, I'm just going to go with satyr for the moment. So these, as D.A. Waite points out here, and this is the usual definition, and we'll come to the more detailed definition, which you can kind of see on the right side of the screen here. But we'll come back to that in a moment. But D.A. Waite's depiction here is about right as far as the usual meaning of this word. And it's the one he provides as a definition. It's this weird creature from mythology. It's not a real creature. It doesn't have, there is no such being that has the ears, legs, and horns of a goat, the head and body of a man, and this fondness for unrestrained lechery. That's just not a, there's not a, such a thing. It's made up. By contrast, Philip Kapusta's King James Dictionary simply defines satyr as he-goat. Now, this definition that Kapusta provides corrects the King James Version. In other words, if you understand that anywhere you see in the King James Version satyr, you should just understand that it means he-goat. If you use that definition, you've corrected the King James in the right way. I mean, it will then be read correctly. And in preparation for this, one question I had to ask myself was, is Philip Kapusta's dictionary here, is it right? In other words, is this just, there are words that have changed over time. The King James English is a combination of English from the century before. So Tyndale started translating the Bible in the 1500s. A century later, almost, the King James translators were polishing the translation that had been given to them. And in some places, they updated the language. In some places, they kept the language the same. So in some places, the language is 100 years old by the time the King James translators start getting to it. In other places, it's fresh at the time of 1611, but not necessarily fresh today. And in some places, in many places, the King James makes perfect sense. In modern English, you don't really need to change anything. That said, what about this word satyr? Is satyr actually a word that means he-goat? If so, then all this is a little bit of a tempest in a teapot, because if he-goat is in fact the right meaning of the term, then it just means that our English has shifted and I should not be giving such a hard time to the King James translators on this point. Maybe we should update the King James Version wording to modernize it. There are certain words in the King James that don't have the same meaning today as they once did, or at least the sense that they were being given in the King James is no longer the sense. There's one place I happen to be looking at Mark Ward's book. I recently picked up a copy of Mark Ward's book called Authorized. And he had mentioned somewhere in here, this is page 31, he mentions bray. He says, Proverbs 27:22, though thou shouldst bray a fool in a mortar among wheat with a pestle, yet will not his foolishness depart from him. Now, from context, you could probably guess that braying someone in a pestle with a mortar means, you know, breaking them up, grinding them, this kind of idea. And indeed, that's correct, but we don't use the word bray that way anymore. And at least not in common speech. I have recently talked about a donkey braying, as Mark Ward points out. Now, I would point out there's something I actually take issue with Mark here. Mark Ward says that there's a word that has changed meaning, which was unicorn. And unfortunately, Mark's just wrong about that. That meaning of the word unicorn in the King James, if you look, I mean, I just encourage Mark to look this up. If you look at the coat of arms of King James, the thing that makes it different from his predecessor's coat of arms is, in fact, a unicorn. The same kind of unicorn that is popular, that the popular meaning of unicorn has today. That's what they thought was a real animal. They didn't know it was a mythological animal at the time, but they thought it was a real animal, but it, in fact, isn't. So, all that to say, there's an interesting third option, which I don't know where the original source is, if it's originally from one of Strong's works or something like that, but Bible Hub and Blue Letter Bible and a few other places have this definition. Satyr may refer to a demon-possessed goat like the swine of Gadara, and refers us to Matthew 8:30-32, where the herd of swine get possessed by legion and this go down a steep cliff into the and drown themselves. So this is a kind of a third option. So there's a deity, which is just a made-up thing. It's not, there's no such deity, of course. Then there's the he-goat, which it gives you the right meaning of the word, but at the question is, was that really the meaning in 1611? And then there's this Bible Hub option, which says, well, it's a goat, yes, but this goat is possessed by a devil, which is an interesting concept. I don't know. And of course, we think that animals can be possessed based on the swine being possessed. But what does the King James intend us to understand? What do the translators intend us to understand? What does it actually mean? And also, what's Will's defense of the King James here? And I found an article by Will from a few years ago. I don't know exactly how many years, but it was a response to John Ankerberg. So I suspect it was at least a decade ago. He says the word translated as satyr is the Hebrew word 8163, satyr. I do notice I'll come to this in a minute. So that's the right word. He says it has several meanings, including hairy, goat, devils, satyrs, and rough. And we'll come back to his points kind of point by point in a moment. But then he says it's found twice in the King James Bible. He points out the two places I've pointed out here, which is Isaiah 13:21 and Isaiah 34:14. Then he kind of goes through some of the other Bible versions that use this word, and then claims that the Septuagint is chock full of things like this. And indeed, it might be. He also claims that satyrs are mentioned in the Septuagint, even at 34, 11, and 14. And maybe we'll come back to that in a bit. Then he goes to the Revised Standard Version of 1952, which still has the word satyrs there in Leviticus, not in the two places the King James has it, but in some other place. And then the Jewish Publication Society, also their translation also has it. And they mentioned a couple other places where this satyrs is found, including a place in 2 Chronicles 11:15. Then he says, what about a modern evangelical version, the New American Standard Version? And he found that there's a place in that version where the satyrs are found. And we'll come back to this, I hope, in a bit. The Smith's Bible Dictionary, here he has the word signifies hairy or rough and is frequently applied to he-goats. In the passages cited, it probably refers to demons of woods and desert places. So this Smith's Bible thinks that it refers to wood demons or desert demons in the places in Isaiah 13 and 34. Then he says that even among various other modern versions, there's little agreement on how to translate it. And he found a variety of translations ranging from shaggy creatures to goats, to goat demons, to goat. I think it should be goat idols, not goat idols, I'm guessing. Demoniacs, hairy ones, demons, wild goats, and evil spirits. So I'm jumping down. His article also addressed some other things. He says, so regarding the correctness of the translation of satyr, Mr. Ankerberg can think what he wants, but there are lots of Bible scholars who differ with his opinion. Again, the Bible versions that sometimes translate this Hebrew word as satyr include both Jewish translations of 1917 and 1936, the Geneva Bible, Moffat's New Translation, and he goes through a list of other ones. The word in question does come from a root that means hairy. I have a better version of this on the blog itself. So when I zoom in, it's too zoomed. But you can kind of see this is an entry from Haylott, and you can kind of just see the meaning of the word. As a noun, it refers to a goat. You can see goat in big letters. Not too controversial. Literally a buck of the goats. In other words, a male goat as distinct from a female goat. And it is true that it has sometimes had a demonic interpretation. So in Hebrew, a type of demon. So more perhaps on that another time. And Jesenius has here, and that's obviously some translation of Jesenius, but hairy or rough, then a he-goat. And then the third definition is wood demons or satyrs resembling he-goats inhabiting deserts. And he quotes these two passages. And then there's some other unrelated word, shower. Now, let's respond to Will's argument. Before I get into Will's argument, some time for some comments. Discerner says, time for a deep dive. Appreciate that, Discerner. Kurt the Gamer says, the verse in question is talking about a demonic goat creature, and it's likely that what was in mind was half man, half goat creature, similar to a satyr or a fawn. And that he thinks satyr is fine as long as it isn't understood as too literal. So we'll come back to whether it's fine or not fine in a moment. Richard Fricks says, I think that's like a communion, bread and wine, church and fan. Good to see you. Patrick's joking around, I think. I don't know. Anyway, we will see what else. Richard Fricks asks, have I read from the Evangelical Heritage Bible and do I think it's a good translation? I don't know if I've read from it. I tend to just go with the King James Version. I think it can be improved, but I think it's a great translation. I don't know about the Evangelical Heritage Bible. It might be a fine translation. I just simply don't know. I would be interested to know, you know, what I'd be looking at is, does it translate from the Masoretic text in the Old Testament? Most translations these days do, but some have too much emphasis on comparing that to the Septuagint. I think that's a mistake to go down that path. And in the New Testament, I would prefer to be using the best possible text of the New Testament. There's not a huge difference between the TR and the Nestle-Aland 28, but there are differences. And I think it'd be better to go with the best possible text in the New Testament. There's a few places where I think the TR is better than the Nestle-Aland, but you know, 9 times out of 10, I think it's almost always the Nestle-Aland that's the one that's got the better reading between the two. But it's not 10 times out of 10, it's something like 9 times out of 10. And there are some exceptions. So anyway, but the question is, can the King James be improved? And I'm focusing now on this satyr term. And while I appreciate that Will knows what word the King James translators were trying to translate, nevertheless, his usage information, which what he provided in his article, slightly obscures the distribution of the semantic range, even just taking the King James Version as a guide to the semantic range. The way that it's translated, according to Strong's lexicon, there's about 59 uses of the term. Of those, about 56 are noun uses, and the remaining 3 are adjectival uses. The 3 that are adjectival are either hairy or rough, and referring to the kind of roughness of the hair, this kind of concept. And it's this rough hair that is the association with the 56, of these 56, 52 of the 56 either are referring to a kid of the goats or just to a goat in general. But either way, some kind of goat, it's 52 of the 56 uses. So almost always it refers to and means goat. And now that leaves us with 2 other things. In 2 places, it's translated as devil. And in 2 places, it's translated as satyr. This is this King James Version's translation. As Will notes, there's these other translations and sometimes other places, like places this has devil, maybe another translation would go satyr there or satyr there. Maybe. But we can kind of come back to this. And you know that, like, if you've seen pictures purporting to be of the devil, some of those pictures of the devil will show him with cloven hoof feet and kind of shaggy legs like a goat. So this idea of associating the devil and goats it's not new. It's been around for a long time. But the question is whether satyr is the right word here in these 2 places. Also, interestingly, I would say this word devil is also not a correct translation, and we could try to discuss that another time. But you'll notice that Leviticus 17 says, they shall no more offer their sacrifices unto devils after whom they've gone a-whoring. This shall be a statute for them throughout their generations. And then again, and he ordained him priests to the high places and for the devils and for the calves which he had made. So in both places, this devil's that's it's being translated as devils, but it really should be a place, not a person. And as a place, it should be defined a little differently. So it's interesting. These two are not correct translations, but they're wrong in they're not wrong in the same way that satyr is. Satyr should just be goat. These two shouldn't necessarily be goats. I think these should really be a specific kind of place, the kind of place where these wild goats live, namely mountains. So, but we'll come back to that. The argument doesn't really hang on that detail. Instead, let's just talk about why these two, the ones that are translated as satyr, why are those two translated as satyr and not translated as goat? According to Will, it's found twice in the King James Bible. That's how he likes to call it, the King James Bible, not just the King James translation. In scripture, he says, the satyr seems to be a hairy, goat-like devil or demon and is portrayed as a real spiritual entity and not as a mythological creature. So I have to say, I noticed that some people have said, we don't want to make it too literal. Like Kurt says, we don't want to understand it too literal. Well, I don't know what's too literal or not too literal. He says it's a real spiritual entity, not a mythological creature. And then Discerner says it's a poetic reference. A short answer is, I think it's just too complicated of a solution. There's an easier, more straightforward solution. He says that it's portrayed this way in scripture. So I think, actually, I appreciate that Will knows which Hebrew word it is, but I think he's cheating by looking at the dictionary definition of the Hebrew word, which it refers to a goat, and which is this hairy creature, and then finding out that there's also this other use out there for it for other things, and then kind of combining those things together to create his definition. That's why he hasn't given you D.A. Wade's definition, which is the mythological creature, nor has he just gone with Kapusta's definition, which is just the correct definition of the Hebrew word. Instead, he has this combo thing where it's a hairy, goat-like devil or demon portrayed as a real spiritual entity, not as a mythological creature. But it's easy for me to say he's just kind of borrowing from my lexicon here rather than actually showing it from scripture. Let's look at scripture. Let's look at the context. And the first one, the context is Isaiah 13, 17 through 22 is the paragraph, essentially, that's the context for this. And I will say up front, this is a true and already fulfilled prophecy of the Medes' destruction of Babylon. It's mentioned here in Isaiah 13. We'll see it's mentioned, well, we'll see the other passage in a minute, but let's look at this one first. And I'm going to read from the King James Version, and I'm not going to change anything. I'm just going to read straight through. Behold, I will stir up the Medes against them, which shall not regard silver, and as for gold, they shall not delight in it. Their bows also shall dash the young men to pieces, and they shall have no pity on the fruit of the womb. Their eyes shall not spare children. And Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the beauty of Chaldees' excellency, shall be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. It shall never be inhabited, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation. Neither shall the Arabian pitch tent there, neither shall the shepherds make their fold there, but the wild beasts of the desert shall lie there, and their houses shall be full of doleful creatures, and owls shall dwell there, and satyrs shall dance there, and the wild beasts of the islands shall cry in their desolate houses, and dragons in their pleasant palaces, and her time is near to come, and her days shall not be prolonged. Now, Discerner says it's a poetic reference. I point that out because there's a certain element of poetry here, certainly. I 100% agree with that. But look in the context. Now, before I get too far down this road, I just want to point out there's a few places where I would say the King James translation is not the best here. One of them is dragons here almost certainly should be jackals, not dragons. And wild beasts of the islands, which is quite a weird choice on its face, since we're talking about something that's not really an island place, and beasts islands aren't distinctively bestial places. Like, there's not like specific island beasts as opposed to other kinds of beasts. But in any event, this wild beast of the islands should be hyenas, and the dragons should be jackals. But whether, even if you would just say, oh no, I think it really is dragons and wild beasts, which is fine. I mean, in Revelation, we talk about the dragon and it's a serpent. That's what it has in mind, as we see by the interchanging use there. So it could very well be, as you know, here also a reference to serpents and wild beasts of the islands. There are islands that have wild beasts on them. But the point is this. In this whole list, there's wild beasts of the point is pretty straightforward. There's not going to be any people there. It's not just that there's not going to be a beautiful city there. It's not even going to have the Arabian nomads there. It's not even going to be a place where the shepherds go to have their flocks. It's going to be a place that's really deserted. The wild beasts of the desert will be the only inhabitants there here. And their house will be full of doleful creatures. These kind of sad, lonely animals, the owls, this says the satyrs, which, and it says they're going to dance there, meaning that the goats are going to be the things jumping around there. That's what this is referring to. That dance means, is a word that means leap. And the idea is goats are the things that are dancing out here now, where there were people before, now there's just going to be these animals that live out in the desert. The deserted area, not necessarily sandy desert, but a deserted area. Wild beasts of the islands. So there's wild beasts of the desert, doleful creatures, owls, this disputed animal, wild beasts of the islands, and dragons. All of these things are animals, whether you think the dragons refers to a hexapod creature or not. These are animals, the wild beasts of the islands, animals. Owls are animals. Again, it might not be the correct translation, but we're just going to say it's owls for now. And the wild beasts of the desert, again, whether that's the right name for the animal, they're animals. They're wild animals that are here. Animals, 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 with satyrs right in the middle. The thing we should probably figure out is that satyrs is a mistranslation of the name of an animal. It's not like animal, 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 mythological creature, animal, 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 or animal, 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 demon, animal, 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 animal. On top of which, satyr isn't a name for a demon. That's not what the word satyr means. It doesn't mean demon. It hasn't meant demon. It means this mythological half man, half goat thing. Or in some other languages, it can have this actually different meaning, which is that there's this similarly named creature in Greek mythology, which is basically a donkey centaur, meaning a man, half man, half donkey, with weird donkey ears and stuff like this. That's another possible meaning of this similar sounding word in Greek, as distinct from the Latin myth, which had this goat man thing. So, and on top of all of this, this is not just a poetic description of a hypothetical destruction. This is talking about an actual destruction of an actual place that really took place. The Medes really did bring judgment against Babylon, and it really was destroyed. This is not a myth. This is a real judgment that was brought by God on a real nation that really deserved it. And it was sad. It was a tragedy. People mourned this at the time, but it was a real thing. It really happened. And putting satyrs in here is not appropriate, because it's just, these are not real creatures. Satyrs are not real creatures. They are mythological. And therefore, it would be better not to have them here in the text. However, you know, I've offered you this explanation from Isaiah 13. What about the other passage? Interestingly, the other passage has an additional challenge that we'll hopefully get into in a minute. But I would like to, before we get there, point out there's nothing in this context, nothing in Isaiah 13, looking at the other things in the list or looking at the parallels between things, you could not possibly get from the context that this is hairy or that it's goat-like, or that it's a devil, or that it's a demon. All of that is not taken from the text of Isaiah 13. It's taken from the lexicon. That's where we'll got it, not from scripture, but from a lexicon. And that's fine, but it needs to be clear that if you're going there, you need to recognize that this is not, there are times when scripture kind of defines itself by conference of places. You can tell from looking at scripture and comparing scripture to scripture what the word means. Like I mentioned with bray earlier, when it says they're going to be he's going to bray them with a mortar and pestle. Well, you can kind of tell what braying them with a mortar and pestle must mean, even if you don't know what the word bray means, because you can figure out what a mortar and pestle do. Mortar and pestle, you grind it up. And so you can get the sense. Maybe you don't get the exact nuance and connotation, but just from the context there, you can figure out that it means kind of breaking down or breaking up or, you know, something like that. And if you figure that out, then you pretty much got the understanding of the word. But you would never get that from looking at the word satyrs here. The only thing that says that, only thing that's said about them is that they dance, which, as I said, dancing here refers to leaping. And I think they've chosen dance because they've decided that it's a satyr. The satyrs are these kind of half human, half goat creatures that can dance like a human, sort of. They kind of prance in a weird way around in the mythology. So this is how they get dance. But there's nothing here about hairy or goat like or any of that other stuff. That was all just brought in from outside. But again, fair enough. But if you, why not just put goat here? It should just be he goats or goats or wild goats. That's the right meaning. And once you put this in, the text actually is not that hard to understand. It's a place where these wild goats live. Wild goats aren't the most social animals. They go out in the places that not a lot of the other animals go, especially like up in the mountaintops where not a lot of people live. It's too cold. It's too, the cliff faces are too, they're not a good living space for most animals. But goats can go there and they make a home there. And that's the way it is. Now, what about Isaiah 34? Well, the whole chapter you kind of need for understanding the context. But again, you'll notice that this context is quite similar. It's another judgment passage about God's vengeance coming upon a place. Come near, ye nations, to hear, and hearken, ye people. Let the earth hear, and all that is in the, all that's therein, the world, and all things that come forth for it, forth of it. For the indignation of the Lord is upon all nations, and his fury upon all their armies. He has utterly destroyed them. He has delivered them to the slaughter. Their slain also shall be cast out, and their stink shall come up out of their carcasses, and the mountains shall be melted with their blood, and all the host of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll, and all their hosts shall fall down, as the leaf falls off of the vine, and as the falling fig from the fig tree. For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Below, behold, it shall come down upon Edomia, and upon the people of my curse to judgment. The sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness and with the blood of lambs and goats, with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah and a great slaughter in the land of Edomia. And the unicorns shall come down with them, and the bullocks with the bulls, and their land shall be soaked with blood and their dust made fat with fatness. For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance and the year of recompenses for the controversy of Zion. And the streams thereof shall be turned into pitch, and the dust thereof into brimstone. And the land thereof shall become burning pitch. It shall not be quenched night nor day. The smoke thereof shall go up forever. From generation to generation it shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever. But the cormorant and the bittern shall possess it. The owl also and the raven shall dwell in it. And he shall stretch out upon it the line of confusion and the stones of emptiness. They shall call the nobles thereof to the kingdom, but none shall be there. And all her princes shall be nothing. And thorns shall come up in her palaces, nettles and brambles in the fortresses thereof. And it shall be an habitation of dragons and a court for owls. The wild beasts of the desert shall also meet with the wild beasts of the island. And the satyr shall cry to his fellow. The screech owl also shall rest there and find for herself a place of rest. There shall the great owl make her nest and lay and hatch and gather under her shadow. There shall the vultures also be gathered, every one of them with her mate. Seek you out the book of the Lord and read. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate. For my mouth has commanded, and his spirit it has gathered them. and he hath cast the lot for them, and his hand has divided it unto them by line. They shall possess it forever. From generation to generation shall they dwell therein. So you can see now this passage, I don't know, discerner may have been had in mind it's a poetic reference. He may have had that in mind more for this passage. There's certainly a lot of poetry or at least vivid imagery in this passage. Things like the sword of the Lord, filled with blood, fat, made fat with fatness. And then there's talk about dust turning into brimstone, streams turning into pitch. The idea of this fiery burning place. There's the idea that Edomia refers to Edom here in Basra. This idea is one of a place full of sacrifice, of death, of destruction. And among those things is this de-inhabitation of the people that were there. And it laying waste the entire area. And you see this scene described as just this horrible place. There's smoke going up forever and ever, like a like an image of hell, the future lake of fire. It's kind of illustrated here. But instead, the cormorant and the bittern shall possess it, two birds, the owl and the raven, two more birds. They talk about the nobles, but there's no nobles. The princes, there's no princes. Instead, in her palaces, where it would be nice flowers and so forth, instead, there's nettles and brambles, and it's a habitation of dragons, animals, not the goal. This, even if we, you know, understand this probably should be jackals, not dragons, but even if it were supposed to be dragons, we'd think of this as wild serpents, not some mythological creature that the scriptures are talking about a real animal. Owls here, wild beasts of the desert, wild beasts of the island. Again, I told you this is hyenas, not actually some kind of island animal. But even if we just take the King James at its face value here, wild beasts living here. And all of a sudden you got this disputed animal, the satyr, and then back to real animals, screech owl, which again might not be the right animal, but it's an animal. And then a great owl, and then the vultures. So you have animal, 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 satyr, animal, animal, animal. Again, in context, it doesn't take a lot to kind of figure out that this animal that's amongst all the other animals, that, you know, birds of a feather flock together, as they say. And if you see a list of, you know, a zebra, a donkey, a word you don't recognize, and then a pony, you can probably figure the word you don't recognize is some kind of horse-like animal because of the rest of the members of the list. And the rest of the members of the list here are various animals, so you can probably figure out the Hebrew word should be translated as some kind of animal. And guess what? There is an animal that this word almost always means, and that's goat. And that's the right animal to put it here. So you might think... that I'm being pedantic here, or kind of I'm trying to hammer this point home too hard, but the King James translators are not dummies, and they know the word goat. They know what that word is. And so how on earth did they not put goat here? And again, before I get to why they did, just note, there's nothing that tells you from this context. It just says they cry to his fellow. A satyr cries to his fellow. Well, that could be all. There's hardly any animals that don't cry to their fellow. There's nothing goat-like about that specific thing. Like there's nothing here about hare, and there's nothing here about devils or demons, at least not in the King James. We'll come to that point in a bit. But there's nothing from the King James that context to tell you this. So once again, this is not coming from the context. This is not coming from the scriptures as such. This is just coming from looking at a lexicon, which again, the lexicon tells you that the primary meaning of this word is goat. And indeed, that's what it should be here as well. But why isn't it there? Well, there's the word here, which seems to be satyr, does sound like, if you say not satyr, like I've been saying, but if you say sayer, satyr, sorry, if you have that T glottalization of the satyr, instead of saying satyr, you say sayer, like people say Satan instead of saying Satan, or people say British instead of saying British. But if you T glottalize that word, satyr, and make it sayer, it sounds quite a lot like the word for wild goat in Hebrew. I'm not sure it sounds exactly like it, but you know, accents change, people's vocalizations change, but it sounds a lot like it, and it seems to be just a false cognate. Will points out some other versions that he says agree. The Jewish Bible is the one that's most the most interesting one of these. Most of these are older versions, but the Jewish Bible, even today, if you go to the Jewish Bible website, I'm trying to remember off the top of my head what it's called. But if you go there, a lot of the words are updated, but this one isn't. And it might be interesting to ask yourself why. The reason why is that there is Jewish commentary. Rashi's commentary is the one that's provided at the link there. But there's Jewish commentary that this refers to a demon. That although the word usually means goat, but that there's this Jewish commentary that says it's a demon. And based on these Jewish commentaries, there's this demonic interpretation of the satyr as and satyr sounds a bit like it. There's an interesting, you know, how they came to make this exact choice is interesting. Sometimes it may have been intended originally to be some kind of transliteration of the word, and it just happens that it also has another sense. The etymology of satyr is interesting to read, or satyr or satyr. This is from the Etymology Online Dictionary, which is a useful resource. It says late 14th century, satyr or satyr, one of the type of woodland deities, part human or animal, demigod or spirit of the air or woods, companion of Bacchus, from the Old French satyr, and directly from Latin satyrus, from Greek satyros, a word of unknown origin. The etymology of satyros is unknown. A number of hypotheses have been proposed, but none of them make sense. So it's this word, we don't know exactly where it came from, and we're the state of the art of etymology just kind of says, well, there is an old Greek word, there's an old Latin word, there's an old French word, and that's where the English got it, but we don't know where the Greek got it from. In pre-Roman Greek art, it's a man with a tail and ears of a horse. And then the conception of part man, part goat comes from Roman sculptures later. So when you think about the fact that there's this satyros in the Greek, this is this donkey centaur creature, some kind of, that's how it's generally put in like modern translations of the Septuagint, to distinguish it from the Roman satyr, which has this fawn like Mr. Tumnus in Narnia. That Mr. Tumnus look is the Roman satyr, not the Greek satyr. In some English Bibles, this etymology says the word is curiously used to translate se'arim, a type of hairy monster. This would be a plural, so types of hairy monsters. A type of hairy monster superstitiously believed to inhabit deserts. And in Middle English, the word could also mean a kind of ape supposed to live in Africa or Arabia. After a use of Greek satyros, and the name was later applied to zoologists to the orangutan. And then it's just used as a term for a very lecherous person as well. That's too late. The 1781 is too late. The idea of using it for an ape is interesting. And at least with if you kind of give the King James translators a benefit of some doubt about what they intended, it's quite possible that they intended it to be this ape that they thought lived in Africa or Arabia, and not to some kind of mythological creature. But it's not impossible they could have had this in mind. But there's a reason why we might think that they didn't. And I'll come to that reason why we might think that they didn't based on looking at John Gill and John Calvin. So John Gill is an excellent scholar of the Bible, I don't always agree with everything he says. I do agree with a lot. But interestingly, one of the strong points for John Gill is he's very familiar with Hebrew sources of his day, including a lot of medieval Hebrew resources. And he explains in his, he has commentaries on both, he has commentaries on the whole Bible, I believe, but he has on Isaiah 13:21, and I'll read his commentary there and then his commentary on 34:14. In 13:21, he says, "And satyrs shall dance there, a sort of monstrous creatures with the ancients painted half men and half goats." This is referring, as I mentioned, to the Latin version, the Roman version. "The upper part of them like men, except for horns on their heads, and the lower parts like goats, and all over hairy." And the word here all used signifies hairy, and is used for goats, and sometimes for devils, either because they have appeared in this form, as Kimchi says. Kimchi is not a Korean commentary, but a famous late medieval or early Renaissance Hebrew commentator. To them that believe them, or because they, by their appearance, inject such horror in men as to cause their hair to stand upright. So the idea is that these devils are so scary looking that you'll get goose flesh and your goosebumps, and your hair on your arms and everything else will just kind of stand up and give you a goat-like appearance. Hence the Targum, Jarchi and Kimchi interpret it of devils here. And so the Septuagint version and those that follow it, the Syriac and Arabic, render "the demons shall dance there." With this agrees the account of mystical Babylon, Revelation 18:2. So Gill points out that there's this interesting connection to Revelation 18:2. We'll come back to that in a moment. But you notice that he says this is referring to demons, not satyrs, not satyrs, but actually to demons. And that's the direction he goes. At least he presents that as an option. I don't know. He's rarely just says, no, the King James is wrong, but this is kind of the way he does it in terms of saying that this means devils or something like that. Then again at 34:14, "And the satyr shall cry to his fellow," or the hairy one, from which the word of the goat has its name. "And these creatures are described by the ancients as half goats and half men," of which Isaiah 13:21. The Targums render it demons, and with this well agrees the account of Babylon or Rome as fallen, "that it shall be the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit," Revelation 18:2. So I think it is interesting, and I don't think I have a copy of Revelation 18:2 here, but Revelation 18:2 does describe Babylon, and you know, of course, it's in a different genre of literature. But it says in 18:1, it says, "After these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." And interestingly, this is a part where I think the critical text has a longer reading, which also brings in the beasts, the wild beasts. But the birds and the beasts, also the devils and foul spirits, are here, though, in Revelation 18:2. So, as far as any case to make the sense of this particular passage, which is talking about Babylon falling, the original Babylon falling, the idea that this Revelation 18:2 passage is in agreement with this understanding is actually the strongest argument in its favor. But the problem is this: just because Revelation 18 is talking about demons doesn't mean that Isaiah was talking about demons. And there's a further problem with this as well. So, as far as defending the King James Version, if it means demons, let's just put demons there, not make up a name that is already used for this half-man, half-goat thing. If we're talking about half man, half goat, then let's say that. If we're talking about demons, let's say that. But even if we say it means a demon, and we're just saying we're going to use the name satyr because it sounds like satyr, and therefore, or satyr, it sounds like satyr, and therefore we're going to use, say, instead of satyr, we're going to use satyr, then okay. But if you're going to base it on the fact that Revelation talks about devils and demons, or spirits and demons inhabiting this place, then you have to consider that there's another part of the text that has a similar demonic understanding in Jewish literature. And that is this word that's translated as screech owl in Isaiah 34, 14. So if I scroll back up, you remember in Isaiah 34, 14, it says, "The screech owl also shall rest there and find for herself a place of rest." But that word that's translated there, screech owl, is interpreted in the Jewish tradition, the same Jewish tradition that calls the goat here a demon. It says by the name, Gil explains it this way. He says, by the name Lilith, that's the name, the Hebrew word here, Lilith, it appears to be a night bird which flies and is heard in the night. The Jews call a she-demon by this name, which they say has a human face and has wings and destroys children as soon as born. And therefore, the Jews, especially in Germany, write upon the four corners of the bed of a new mother, Adam, Eve, out Lilith. The same with the Lamia of the Romans, and so the Vulgate Latin here renders it, according to Gill again. So there's this word that King James has at screech owls. Well, if you're going to, on the basis of Jewish authority, use a demon name for one of the animals, how can you not use on the same authority Lilith, a demon name, for the other animal? It's just simple consistency would demand that. Now, the better way to do this is not to insert the names of demons into here or to treat this as a demonic reference, but it's better just to treat this as a reference to an animal. And now, I would be interested to see which animal it is, but this is the Jewish interpretation is this she demon interpretation. And if the King James, let's put it this way, the argument that this is a she demon is a lot stronger than the argument that the word for goat here refers to demon. The word for goat meaning demon would require you to take a word that's normally translated as goat and give it a different meaning. Whereas Lilith isn't a word that's used a lot in the Hebrew Old Testament. In fact, if I recall correctly, that's just the one place it's used. Now, maybe there's some similar words somewhere else, but anyway, we'll kind of pause there and consider what were the King James translators themselves thinking. Were they thinking ape? Were they thinking something else? And we don't have access to their minds, but we do have access to Calvin's commentaries on Isaiah. And Calvin's commentaries on Isaiah tell you what Calvin thought and probably what the King James translators were thinking as well. He says this in Isaiah 13. He says, "It will not be amiss to explain what follows about satyrs or pans, who are sometimes called by the French, according to the various dialects of the provinces, sometimes Luton, sometimes Follet, and sometimes Loup-garou. As Satan deludes men by various tricks, so he gives to them various names. It is certain that a tsim is often used in scripture for devils, and it's derived from tsiya, which means a dryness or a desert, as iam is derived from iam, which means to terrify. The devil performs strange tricks by means of fauns and satyrs, and upon that account, their names are given to them." So he's saying that these names are the tricks that are performed by give the names to these creatures that he thinks exist. Satyrs or pans, if you've seen depictions of Pan, he has this kind of goat-like look to him. The design of the prophet is to show the solitude will be so great that not only will the place be deserted by men, but even the devils will there deceived by their tricks. For the devils avail themselves of the tendency of solitary places to produce terror, as enemies and robbers, by sallying forth from concealed lurking places, frighten men the more. So devils take advantage of the night and the darkness, and of places distant from the view of men, that they might be able to excite greater terror in those who are naturally timorous," meaning fearful. So the main idea that Calvin has here, which is that this is going to be a place deserted by men, that's right, of course. That's clearly what Isaiah 13 is talking about. Now, this sidebar about demons and demons liking to trick people and terrify people, this doesn't make a lot of sense if they're doing this out in a place where there aren't any people. It doesn't make a ton of sense. You'd think that demons who are trying to trick people and scare people would come to where the people are to scare them. But, this is how, this is how Kelvin was thinking it through, that there's this, like, in remote places, people are naturally afraid, and the demons just take advantage of it and terrify them the more. So if someone is passing through this, you know, remote place, the demons will use this to their advantage. I don't think that Calvin's right here, but I think this gives you a sense, or at least a window of insight, into what people of the time were thinking, especially the King James translators, who we have every reason to believe were influenced by Calvin and his commentaries. Calvin's commentary on Isaiah 34 says, "And the wild beasts shall meet with the satyrs. These animals are thought by some commentators to mean fawns." Fawn is basically another word for satyr, this half man, half goat. "By others, screech owls or goblins, and by others, satyrs. And it is not fully agreed what is the exact meaning of the Hebrew words." So this is excellent. And this is also, by the way, what the King James translators put in their preface, that there's certain things like names of animals and gemstones and so forth, where they're not sure what it means. But they put, and they don't even think in some places the Jewish translators knew what it meant. They just kind of put something there rather than not put anything there. So that they acknowledge that in their preface to the reader. But anyway, he says it's not fully agreed what's the exact meaning. And he's right. There wasn't a fully exact understanding of Hebrew at that time. And to say that it's absolutely perfect understanding now might be a mistake, but certainly we've had quite a lot of additional time to develop understanding of Hebrew through cognate studies of other Semitic languages, especially other ancient Near East Semitic languages, such as including languages that are now gone, that weren't available in any ready form for people in the early Renaissance or even mid-Renaissance. They just weren't there for them. So anyway, we continue on. He says, "But it would serve no good purpose to give ourselves much uneasiness about them. For it's quite enough if we understand the meaning and design of the prophet." And I agree with Calvin on this point. We shouldn't, although I'm insisting that this word that usually means goat also means goat here, we don't need to get too sidetracked by this. It's not as though by reading the King James, you're getting this totally different picture of the gospel than you would have. The main point is, as he says, and Calvin says, he draws a picture of frightful desolation. That's exactly the right understanding. That's what he meant. That's what he's saying. "As if he had said that Idumea shall be destroyed so as to be without inhabitants." Again, exactly right, Calvin. "And instead of men, it shall be inhabited by frightful beasts." Once again, we're all on the same page. "This reward is most justly reaped by the ambition of those who built costly palaces to be, as we have already said, monuments of their name and reputation. Yet this is also a punishment threatened against the cruelty of a wicked nation, which was eagerly bent on the oppression of neighbors and brethren." So far, we're tracking exactly. Now, again, here's where Calvin goes in a place where I wouldn't go. He says, "Though we cannot absolutely determine whether the prophet means witches or goblins or satyrs or fauns, yet it is universally agreed that these words denote animals which have the shape of men. We see also what various delusions are practiced by Satan, what phantoms and hideous monsters are seen, and what sounds and noises are heard. But of these, we have already spoken under the 13th chapter." So I think this is the part which he says it's universally agreed that they have the shape of men. I think Calvin has made an interesting generalization here that goblins, satyrs, fauns, and witches, if those are the various meanings people are assigning, are kind of humanoid monsters, but they're not humans. So they're animals which have the shape of men. I mean, he's not wrong about that generalization. The problem is that the better answer is just these are wild goats. And we don't have to go down the path of demons and so forth here. He says, we also see what various delusions are practiced by Satan, what phantoms and hideous monsters are seen. Again, that's an unnecessary leap here. Not that those things aren't true, just that they're not necessarily what's here. And thankfully, this universal agreement about the words has lapsed, if it was ever really universal. So I've gone for an hour. That's my thoughts in a nutshell on satyr. I don't think that there's, or satyr or satyr, I don't think there's any good reason to leave the King James the way it has been. I think I mentioned that I would point out this dictionary entry. This is the Oxford English Dictionary, one of the really the leading premier dictionary. This is the entry it has for satyr. Looks like satyr. I don't know, the AE ligature, satyr, I guess. And it says it's from Latin satyrus, satyria plural, and it even tracks it back to satyros in Greek, which we already talked about in terms of the etymology of the word. Let me scroll this carefully. First is the mythological meaning. This is the primary meaning in the Oxford English Dictionary. And this is this wood class of woodland gods or demons, partly human, partly bestial, supposed to be companions of Bacchus. In Greek, it was with the ears and tail of a horse. It wasn't necessarily with the legs of the horse, but kind of ears and tail. So they sometimes referred to as a donkey centaur. That's one of the ways it's described in by some people. Roman sculptors assimilated that with the faun, giving it the ear, tails, and legs of a goat with budding horns. Like Satan is often depicted with this kind of imagery. In the English Bible, the word is applied without precedent, either in the Septuagint or the Vulgate, to hairy demons or monsters of Semitic superstition supposed to inhabit deserts. So then they go through and the OED provides some usage from Chaucer, some usage from Trevisa, from Gower, from Caxton, from Sanford, from Petit, and even Robert Scott, I believe, and Nash, and Locrine, and Shakespeare, Hamlet, and the King James Bible, and Congreve, and Mrs. Jameson. And so you'll notice that per the OED, which is not infallible, but it is a useful guide for English, this is this mythological interpretation, applying it to these hairy demon monsters, is the one that's seemingly the one that's being selected, as opposed to the ape, which they've mentioned, I think, a little bit below. Here it also says figuratively it's used for the type of lustfulness. I won't describe how satyrs are illustrated, but you can guess that they're somehow not kid-friendly. Let's put it like that. It also, they gave rise, the fact that this is similar, satyric and satyric are similar, gave rise to the notion that satyrs who formed the chorus of Greek satyric drama had to deliver satirical speeches. So it seems to be another false friend here, this idea of satire and satyrs are, they're not the same thing, but they were, there's some confusion about that. But again, nothing to do with this. And then this kind of ape, possibly from the Greek satyros, and subsequently another term for an orangutan, and there's some evidence of usage like this from as close to the King James Version as 1398, but also 1613. Now, notice, though, that this one from 1614 says that the satyrs have feet like goats. And the this goat-like feet do make it sound more like the Roman imagery and less like an actual orangutan or other ape, and then the 1698 refers to this kind of men of the woods, which is a reference to orangutans, actually. Let's see. Then it says any butterfly of the group Satyridae. So it's definitely not that meaning, although that is one of those words that's out there. And there's mention of satyr dancing and so forth. So you can understand with this reference to the pan as an example of a half man, half goat god, that dancing with them would be natural. So all this to say, what do the King James translators mean? They meant a half man, half goat creature. Possibly they intended it to be a demonic creature, but they did mean the half man, half goat thing. Is it a spiritual creature? Well, there's nothing in the King James to tell us that. There's nothing in the historical definition of this to tell us that, except that there was this demon Jewish tradition associated with the word. But if that tradition is strong enough to win you over that this should in fact be some kind of name of a demon rather than just a goat, despite it almost always just meaning goat, then why in the world would you accept Screech Owl and not Lilith here, since the tradition on this word is much stronger and the use of this word for Screech Owl, at least in the Bible, is much lower? So I think you can't consistently just say, well, the Jewish tradition says it was a demon, so it must be a demon. So anyway, having gone for an hour, I've gone through most of this. Discerner says he's looked at the EHE and nothing remarkable, which I guess means it's probably just fine. I don't know. I'm just not sure. Pat Churchin fans, when atheists say the Bible is full of mythology, it does not help for them to be proven correct by the inclusion of mythology in the form of unicorns. Right. Well, sure. But the King James translators didn't realize at the time that it was a mythological animal. They thought it was a real animal, and that's why they used the term. They wouldn't have used it if they didn't think it was a real animal. They were just wrong about that, and that's okay. They're just the translators. They're not, you know, they weren't inspired prophets of God or something like that. They're just the translators, and they got it wrong. And they had the Septuagint, which had mono, a word that kind of literally looks like it means one horn, and that they thought that was right. It wasn't right, but no, that's what they thought at the time. So, yeah, I'm not defending the King James on that point, but it is, in fact, the wrong thing. Same thing here. We shouldn't have satyrs or satyrs here. There's no such animal. There never was. Just put goats. That's what it is, wild goats. And a lot of the new translations will do that. I'm trying to, the Jewish Bible doesn't do it, but that's because they're influenced by Jewish tradition. I understand why that would do it for them, but that shouldn't do it for us. We should just follow what the text actually says. And I appreciate Gil's appeal to Revelation 18, but mystical Babylon there does not necessarily equate to the Babylon described in Isaiah 13 or Isaiah 34. And therefore, it's fine for those in those descriptions in Isaiah for it to just be wild beasts, and for the description in Revelation 18 to include demons. But if you find Gil's appeal to Revelation 18 compelling, stop putting satyrs here and just put demon, if you think that's what it is. Say woodland demon. But satyrs doesn't conjure up that meaning in the mind of people. They think of little half-man, half-goat creatures. So this is not the correct translation, even if it is a demon. Shaggy creature, yes. Shaggy creature is just another way of saying wild goat. Although it's interesting that they don't use wild goat here, of all things. It's kind of puzzling why they don't use that. I'm sure there's a story behind it. Then there's also in Daniel, there's the shaggy goat in Daniel. I forget what it's called. I think it's called like a rough goat in the King James Version. It's the shaggy goat in some of the other versions. And there it's just like these two words for goat side by side. But it's not the demon goat. Although in Daniel's vision, a demon goat would be perfectly fine as an item in a vision. Even a satyr in a vision is perfectly fine. There's no problem having a vision of an animal that doesn't exist. Look at some of the animals in the vision with 10 horns. That's not a real animal. There's not real animals with 10 horns, but it's just a vision. So you can have all kinds of things in a vision. But anyway, in Daniel, everyone has goat, hairy goat, shaggy goat, he goat, buck of the goats, something like this. But that's what it means. It's a male goat, the shaggy goat, long-haired goat, something like that. And that's, you know, that's the meaning. That's how the King James Version could be improved. As I mentioned, this is part of a larger discussion of improvements to the King James Version that we could make. including harmonizing name spellings where there's absolutely no point to using different spellings. So either pick Balak or Balak, but there's no point to have sometimes have it a C and sometimes have it a K. It just doesn't make any sense. It's not like the C is a better way in some places and a K is a better way in the other places. Just have one. Timotheus or Timothy, it's the same guy. Just pick a name and go with it. And it could even be a third one, like Timotheos, which I'm saying it like that to emphasize the OS instead of this Latin US. It would be fine to use Timotheos if that's what you want. But just pick one and go with it. There's no reason out of 28 times to have 19 one way and 9 the other way. And then most curiously of all is this Simeon instead of Simon in Acts 15:4. So in Acts 15:4, the text says Simeon, and that makes a reader who's reading through this think, what Simeon are you talking about? Now, if you say, well, the reason is because the Greek actually usually has Simon, but here it does have Simeon. Okay, fine. I accept that. Maybe it's fine to just use Simeon here because Luke used Simeon here. But then if that's the case, at 2 Peter 2:1-1, you should put Simeon, which is what the Greek has, and not Simon, which is what the King James has. So just pick one, but be consistent about it. Or if you're going to say, well, you're going to call him Simon Peter because that's what everyone knows him as, then just call him Simon Peter in Acts 15:14 as well. And just pick one. This doesn't change any big doctrine. This is not a big doctrinal issue. Balak spelling with a C or a K, that's not a doctrinal issue. Timotheus picking one, that's not a doctrinal issue. But these are ways the King James could be improved. And these are three of these ways. Names of animals, the unicorn. It's not a unicorn, it's a ream. Satyr is a wild goat, and we could go on and on. And why does everyone latch on to the name Lilith? Jewish tradition. That's the short answer. Or they watched too much of Frasier. I don't know. But I think that it's because of Jewish tradition. And then Passover is the wrong word to describe Easter. Now, this one's interesting because at the time, the word Passover... the word Passover was coming into use. It was almost universally used as distinctly the name for the Jewish festival, and Easter had become almost exclusively used for the Christian festival. But when the Bishop's Bible was made and when previous editions of the New Testament in English were made at that time, Tyndale hadn't, the very first time was when Tyndale translated. Oh, well, not the very first time, but when Tyndale first translated the New Testament, he hadn't come up with the word Passover yet. Everyone just used Easter for both the Jewish feast and also for the Christian celebration of Christ's resurrection. This distinction between Passover and Easter came later. Brian Ross compellingly argued, I think, for this point. But the problem is now the word Easter isn't used to refer to the Jewish feast. So it's misleading. It should be improved by changing it. And in fact, the King James translators changed it everywhere else. They should have just been consistent again and finished the job here. And that's an update that would be helpful and would avoid people thinking they were talking about the Christian holiday, which wasn't as such being celebrated yet. And then there's these issues, like this issue in Revelation 15:4, not a doctrinal issue, Agios versus Osias. In fact, they're kind of synonyms. They're more or less synonyms in Greek. How can you tell which is which? And the short answer is, from the King James, you can't tell which is which. There is a TR reading, but how can you tell whether the TR is right? In other words, whether the Nestle Aland 28 is right, if the majority actually has the other reading? How do you know? And I think the short answer is you can't possibly know from the King James which is right. The King James can't tell you that kind of information, which Greek word it is, if they're two synonymous Greek words. Now, maybe you'd say it just doesn't matter. We don't need to know. Okay, but if we're trying to get the original text, then you kind of need to know whether it's one or two, word one or word two. And then where the TR disagrees with the Nestle Aland 28 and the majority. And there I go to Revelation 16:5, which I've been discussing probably to ad nauseum to everyone who follows this channel. So I will stop sharing the screen there, and I will try to wrap things up. Thank you to everyone who has been in here. Thanks to Michelle Cherie, KJV. Thanks to Discerner. Thanks to Richard Frooks. Thanks to Kurt the Gamer. I really appreciate each of you coming here and contributing. Oh, and Patrick Brennan, I didn't mean to skip you. thanks to Patrick as well. Thanks to each of you for contributing to this discussion. I do appreciate it. I appreciate listening. And I look forward to next Tuesday. We have, at the usual time, God willing, we will be discussing Poirier's book, The Invention of the Inspired Text, which I hope will be an interesting read. We've invited him to join us, but I think he won't be able to make it, or he won't be able to, or won't want to. I don't know. We're not necessarily taking the most Poirier promotional take, I suspect, at least not as much as he might wish for as the author. But in any event, that's the plan for this coming Tuesday. Dan and I will be, God willing, discussing that topic. I don't know if we'll have more episodes before then, but whether or not we do, God be with you.